Sales is a life skill, and you need to be able to sell yourself an idea or a product if you want to accomplish anything in life.
Ignition sequence start. 3, 2, 1.
Aaron, how's it going?
That's a very complex and loaded question you're asking me there, Dan. Really,
I know.
You want to start off on a tough.
That is a hard hitting question.
I thought this would be a puff piece.
No, hard hitting. Dude, you've been a staple in the SaaS space with your books, authorship, blogging. I know that you've, and that's one question I want to ask about, like, how did you end up co-writing the book with Jason Lemkin? Like, I never got the backstory to that.
Oh yeah, and the From Impossible to Inevitable book?
Yeah, it's like my go-to when people are like, okay, I'm ready to scale. What should I read? That's the foundational book.
Yeah, okay. We just updated it a couple recently.
I saw that.
So.
Yeah.
So the way it came about was, for me, I really need partners to do things. That's how, like I say, hey, I'm not Elon Musk, who seems like he's got infinite motivation, whether he does or not, I don't know. For me, like, I get tired, and we have a big family. We have 9 going on 11 kids.
Yes. Yeah.
Got a $5 million business. So I got business, big family. I procrastinate. I get anxious about kind of perfectionism.
You're human.
Yeah,
okay.
I definitely have all my faults.
Okay.
So what cuts through the noise and my resistance, it's called just procrastination, or busyness, is partners and deadlines, right? So having a partner on something means I've got not only someone to show up for, but also it just makes it more enjoyable to kind of bounce ideas off of.
Collaborate.
And then having deadlines, of course, deadlines make the world
forcing
go round.
Forcing function, yeah.
Forcing functions, right? And that was in the book. So when I thought about, hey, it just was time to do a new book, and it was more of a feeling. I think sales, Predictable Revenue had been out for 4 or 5 years, say 4 years. I knew Jason from a few years ago. He started blogging a bit.
Just Quora. He went nuts on Quora.
Yeah, and this is, I think, before that. But okay. I really liked his stuff.
Yeah.
I think I saw it on Facebook. And I reached out to him and said, hey, would you want to do a book? And he said, sure.
Wow.
Basically. So at that point, and he kind of left it up to me, publisher or not, and I had self-published Predictable Revenue. Mm-hmm. There's pros and cons to that.
Yeah.
This time, decided to try Wiley as a publisher. There's pros and cons to that. So got a publisher, and then we had deadlines. So I think ultimately it's really I wanted a partner. I really respected Jason's material. Mm-hmm. I'd say more than anyone else in the kind of the SaaS revenue writing space. There's a lot of great writers. His was just so complimentary to mine.
Yep.
And again, this is before he was like Mr. Big Shot. Yeah. I think in that way. And it was probably, I think, over a couple years it took to get the book done.
Okay. Like so start to finish, about 24 months kind
Something
of thing?
Like that. 18 months, couple. I could go back, but I think because there were some ebook and kind of beta tests I started with. So and then in terms of the way to do it, I like smaller steps. So
yeah, didn't
I,
you blog Predictable Revenue for the most part?
Yeah. The two books are created differently. So Predictable Revenue started off as a blog. Mm-hmm. When I was at Salesforce, actually banned blogging, because this is back in like 2004.
Wow.
So blogging was illegal or whatever the term was.
Yeah.
But I started just for myself to find my voice. Tried some sales blogging. I did some other things. And then after a few years, there was all these blogs. And I thought about doing a book. I actually had a contract with Wiley, which is a book publisher, when I left Salesforce. So long story short, I got married. Had kids, had to make more money.
Yep.
Had to publish the book, forcing function.
Great.
Yep. So finally published the book, again, procrastination. The good news is by waiting on doing it and doing consulting and more writing and speaking, I'd crystallized the book to be a better book than if I had done it years earlier.
So do you feel like that's your creative process, is to put it out the world, get some feedback, iterate, try it again?
Yeah, it's kind of commit to something and then figure how to do it. And honestly, we do that with kids.
Yep.
Let's do an adoption, and we'll kind of we have a baby we're in the process of adopting, and do we know how we'll handle the kind of the load? Because I don't know, you've had kids, the baby stage is a rough one. It's very rough. Let's just be honest about that.
Okay,
last night,
I'm very honest.
There was a woman entrepreneur who was like, can I swear here?
Yeah, you can swear, man. This is
I was like, I fucking hate babies. Not of course, but like
the woman said this. Was she a mother?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, because it's not so much the babies themselves as everything around the exhaustion.
Oh, it's not sleeping, man.
Yeah.
It's.
I don't think people actually talk about that much.
No.
So, but once you get to 18 months, 2 years, 2.5 years, that
just
magic starts.
Special.
Yeah, so much magic. So again, let's commit to have, we just felt important to adopt a child, and this happened before because mm-hmm. we've adopted four so far. And kind of like, we don't know how to pay for it. Maybe we may not know how we're going to handle the load, and we just figure it out. Yeah. But the book, commit to the deadline and then figure it out.
Work from back.
Conferences. There's so many times I've committed to doing a talk, whether I was putting it on myself or showing up, and I'm like, I'm not sure what I'll do. Maybe I'll just come up with a title and then I'll fill it in later.
Fill in the blanks.
So it's burning burning my bridges, burning my ships.
No plan
B. That works
B.
for me.
Yeah.
Again, it cuts through the procrastination.
You like the pressure.
I don't know if I like it, but it works.
I'm the same way. Yeah. I actually have a trick where if I'm speaking like an event, they'll be like, hey, send us your slides, 2 weeks prior. And I just update the first slide of some old talk and I send it to essentially be the first person to hand in their slide and then come the day of and be like, here are my actual slides.
Actual ones.
They hate me for it, but at least I feel like it's a medium ground because I'm that way. It's like I need to do more creative things closer to when I can get in the headspace.
Yeah.
Is that how you are?
Yeah, I am. Because I feel like the day before is when I'm like really thinking and I have like the most relevant, useful information at that point. Doing stuff too far advanced, just it's kind of disconnected from that event. So, yeah.
So one thing that you've written, I think it's like 2011?
I think that's where procrastination actually helps sometimes.
Totally.
So
it's a creative.
I don't know if that's the right word. It's like getting your timing right.
It's knowing knowing thyself around the creative process. Mm-hmm. My brain's not ready to go in the place it needs to produce.
Amen, brother.
Early. You're very well known for cold emailing 2.0, essentially a strategy that you wrote about. I think it's 2011 or 2010 you first wrote about.
Yeah, 2011 in the book. Yeah.
Yeah, and then on the blog. What's changed since then? So concept for those that don't know, this is the way I've always implemented, email the company asking who's the person in charge of this area of the business. They forward you off to the right person, and then you use that kind of social credibility mm-hmm. to move the conversation forward. What's changed? Because the tool sets have come out of the woodwork since then. The volume, everybody's doing kind of some kind of cadence for Outbound.
Yep.
You guys do this at your Predictable Revenue.
Yep.
What's changed in that strategy or approach?
Yeah, that's a great question. Because back in the 2000s, when I was at Salesforce, and even 2011 and so on, there wasn't as much cold email. And in the Predictable Revenue book, specifically talked, like I said, using cold email to get referrals. Now, that's not the only technique at Salesforce you use, but that was probably the most interesting and different. So today, there's a lot more technology to do that. There's 1,000 applications to send email and follow up and do phone calls. And there's SalesLoft and Outreach are two popular ones.
Yeah.
There's a lot of them. So generally, there's this kind of Uber trend of overwhelm across the world. Right? There's more apps. Every niche is crowded. There's more channels. There's more messages. There's more content. So everyone's overwhelmed in general. So I know there's these people, if you've heard the fact that buyers are more educated than ever. No, they're not. They're more confused than ever. Right? There's 500, there used to be 500 sales apps. Now there's 5,000, and then a few years, there'll be 50,000. So this overwhelm is everywhere. There's too much email. So the principles are the same. Really, the Predictable Revenue book and kind of the cold calling 2.0 approach of outbound prospecting, right? That's the function and team I created at Salesforce.com. Yep. It was really about having a funnel. It's having a system, a repeatable system. Whether it's a cold email or cold call, is not the point. It was you have a predictable way to generate leads, and if you can do that, then you can create predictable revenue. So the funnel's the same. The techniques are a little bit different, but not that different. What I find is that having more email, sort of like in marketing, more content, you just need to be more on point with who your customer is, what they care about, and kind of understanding the way to reach them. We do a lot, so PredictableRevenue.com is a company that does outsourcing and training all around outbound prospecting. Mm-hmm. We do a lot around LinkedIn now. So again, email, LinkedIn, calls, it's like whatever works.
There's messages and there's channels.
Yeah, there's messages, there's channels. It's like knowing your customer, knowing the kind of messages and their problems and knowing the channels and being able to test those. So now we do a lot more like projects around what we call outbound validation, kind of first projects are to like hyper test, 20 or 40 different kinds of message channel target mixes to try to nail the right details for that right customer.
Does it look more like ABM in that sense or account-based marketing?
No.
No?
No, ABM's different. Yeah. Yeah, it's really more, at a level around most customers aren't specific enough around the kinds of companies that are really the best fit and the kinds of people and what they
and
really
want.
And what
their hook is going to be for interest.
It's like drilling a lot deeper into the psyche of your customer, because most companies, it's kind of this nailing a niche, which is like really working to understand the types of customers you've got, who needs you the most versus when are you a nice to have. And really kind of, again, reading their mind, the customer's minds on what are they thinking? Like, what do they want? Mm.
Well, I know that some people, when it comes to marketing, they talk about just like the copy or the lexicon. Like, you know, some companies will call it, you know, they have clients or customer. I mean, a gym membership has members, lawyers have clients, you know, et cetera, patients, if you're a doctor. Is that what you're trying to test to figure out for that target customer? What are the words that are going to resonate?
Yeah,
how does that look like?
You want there to be whether it's email, phone calls, LinkedIn, whatever, you want there to be the least translation possible.
Oh, that's a good way to look at it.
So again, if I'm cold calling a gym, I don't want to say, hey, are you trying to get more customers? I would say, hey, are you trying to get more members, like you said. I find
translation possible. It's a good way to look at it.
Yeah, because the more kind of mental work
cognitive
I need to translate
to
understand what you're saying, the less likely I will get it.
If they don't get it, you got no chance.
No. So it's called email. They have to be. The reason that short and sweet emails work, and they do, is because if I send a long email to you and you don't know me, even if you do know me, and there's like a lot of, like I said, what is it, cognitive overhead, like a lot of
you're
mental
making me
work
think.
To read it.
Don't make
I'm
me
like,
think.
I'm more likely to ignore it or just put it off till later. If it's a really short email, easy to understand,
one
simple
call
to answer,
one, yeah. yes or
I'm
no.
at least more likely to respond.
Yeah.
And one of the reasons like the referral email works, and again, we say, hey, there's ways to send referral emails and there's ways to send direct emails, which is, hey, will you take an appointment? But the referral one works well because it's such a simple ask. If I ask you for an appointment, that's a big ask, 20 minutes of your time. If I ask for you to point me towards someone else, that's really simple. Boom, you're done. So again, it's one tool in your tool set. It's not your only tool.
Yeah.
Right. So typically, for prospectors, they want to know how to make a certain kinds of phone calls. They want to know how to send a referral email, a direct email. LinkedIn's a bit different. So if you have a set of tools, sometimes you need a screwdriver, sometimes you need a hammer.
Yeah.
You can't have 20 tools because then you're just kind of overwhelmed, but you want to get good at a half dozen or so
that
tools
work for your market.
Yep.
And you can tweak it. One thing that, you know, people, this is like on naming things, do you call them, if somebody's doing outbound prospecting, is it BDRs or SDRs in your world?
We just use SDRs typically, but you know, it's confusing because some companies call, there's inbound SDRs, responding to inbound leads.
Yeah.
And again, really common mistake is having SDR, sales development reps, these junior salespeople that are juggling both responding to inbound leads and doing outbound prospecting.
Two different.
That's a no-no. They're actually totally different jobs.
Totally different.
That at the surface look similar because of the labels SDR and they're doing leads and making calls.
Qualifying, yeah.
But the jobs are completely different.
The context of those people coming
totally,
in.
And totally. And the mindset. Different. So BDRs are common.
MDRs, market development reps.
Yeah, that's all over. MDRs,
but
LDRs.
Same thing, essentially. You're helping people build top of like pipeline.
It's basically either prospecting for them or kind of helping them build or fix their outbound prospectors, which they usually call SDRs, but the team of dedicated outbound prospectors make sure they actually work in a sustainable way.
And do you feel
harder
like
than people realize?
Totally. It's crazy hard. We've talked about this before around like ACV size. Like when you guys take a client, what does a perfect client look like for you guys, a predictable revenue in regards to if they look like this, we feel we're going to be incredibly successful.
Yeah. Well, I think usually it's kind of like if outbound is a fit for them, then we could help them. So it's kind of the same thing, which is if you have a type of customer that has, let's call it like a lifetime value of at least $20,000. So that ACV or ARR can look a bit different, you know, maybe $3,000 to $5,000 ACV ARR, then outbound can be a fit, especially if it's a product. So then there's lots of ways we can help that company. Product companies have an easier time doing outbound just because it's when you're selling a concrete thing, it's easier, again, mental overload.
Yeah.
There's less translation. It's easy. Oh, it's a chair. I understand that.
I need to
sit
down.
It's a CRM. It's a this. Yeah. services tend to be more
solution,
vague.
Because they're solution focused.
A little more vague. Right? So I think if you have a services company, it doesn't mean outbound can't work. It means that you have to try to find ways to make...
Productize it.
Productize a simple step.
Yeah.
Like a first step.
Lead generation.
Yeah. Or for a lot of companies, even consumer companies, outbound can work, or for sometimes B2B companies that sell to like individuals, yeah. But it's more of a channel
like
approach.
Like insurance products or...
Yeah. Or we had, there's a customer that sold database backup services.
Okay.
You know, like $10 a month.
Yeah.
Really cheap, but yeah. They had channel partners. So they used Outbound to get channel partners, VARs and other channel partners.
Okay, so they use Outbound for the partner side.
You can use Outbound. It's the same process to get partners, the same process actually in a marketing function. We have an Outbound marketing SDR. They do the same process to get interviews on like webinars and podcasts and blog posts.
And on the Outbound channels, I mean, LinkedIn seems to be picking up steam. I was never a LinkedIn user. Now it's a primary thing I do. Strategy-wise, what can you share in regards to like some of the lesser known things? Like I've heard people like, you know, visiting profiles and then you show up and you message and like, what's the cadence sequences that you feel are the appropriate way to do it? Kind of like what's the email 2.0 or cold call 2.0
for LinkedIn? LinkedIn's been a growing part of our business. So on our outsourcing side of the business, there's at least one customer I know that does almost all of their appointments through LinkedIn.
Would it be a higher ACV customer typically for LinkedIn?
You know, it just depends on the market, honestly.
Okay.
You know, depending if you're targeting you know, like sales professionals versus engineering, some types of markets and functions are more on LinkedIn and some aren't. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of depending. We can't always say, hey, is email or LinkedIn or the phone going to be a better fit for you? Kind of have to test and try some different things. If you have your own internal team, you want to do all three, of course.
Yeah.
But on LinkedIn, what we've seen, we have something called Outbound Labs, our internal kind of testing organization. And LinkedIn tends to have a more kind of ideas, it works better when you have more of a hey, let's share ideas approach.
Yeah.
And I think we've all gotten messages on LinkedIn, which is this long, hey, do you need software development services? Do you need, it's like a pitch.
My whole inbox.
So what we've seen work is more of like, hey, Dan, I see you're in the entrepreneurial space and kind of so am I. Would you want to get together, share ideas sometime?
Yeah.
It's a very kind of rough version of it.
Yeah.
So that might be the connection request. And that first follow-up could be, again, short and sweet. Could be one or two or three sentences, just following up with a prior message. And we have a guy named Brendan who's really smart about this. And
personalized, yeah, right? You see something they shared. Hey, I saw that you shared this article.
It'd be nice. You don't have to, though.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, so again, you're kind of looking at this. There's, I think, a lot of experts that rightly say you have to personalize, but they will go too far, which is you have to personalize everything.
Everything. And you're thinking about segments?
So again, know your market. There are some uber-specific markets where you might have to personalize everything. Personalization tends to take a lot of time. So can you think about throughput? Or tools in your tool set. So I'm a prospector. I need to know how to personalize an email or LinkedIn message, but I also need to know how to send more of a template because sometimes I want to do one or the other. Throughput would be if I spend 2 hours to personalize two messages, but I get 100% response rate, or four messages and 100% response rate, okay, versus if I spend 2 hours to send a campaign of 100 messages, but I get a 4% response rate. It's kind of the same throughput. Yeah. There's pros and cons to each. If you only have 20 customers in your entire market versus you have 5,000. So again, kind of basic principles are know who your ideal customers are, kind of know how to test ways to reach them, to teach your team a few kind of different tools. But the goal is not to be a robot to follow the process. The goal is to understand for them who the customer is, have a few different tools to get the information and to figure out if there's a fit or not. And then move them, if there is a fit, move them on to an appointment somehow.
And what are the, I mean, it changes in the market from time to time. What are some of the services for data, for building lists? What's your approach to kind of...
Oh, man, the data, it's so crazy.
It's crazy, man.
Yeah, and that's probably the most dynamic part of the market with things coming and going.
G2 crowd, like letting you know when, like notifications of when organizations are looking at your profile.
Yeah, so that list sources, I mean, Zoom Info, you know. Yeah. So... it's hard to stay on top of it all. I mean, I think we work with like 30 something different data sources.
Wow.
Net Prospects is a top one.
Yeah.
Zoom Info,
there's
I think clear
is a pop, bit. Like tons.
Because with Zoom Info merging or acquiring Discover.org, that's been a popular one.
Yeah.
A lot of it comes to
Is there a site that talks about this that somebody could go check whenever they're
probably
listening?
I actually don't know what it is.
Yeah,
we don't
me neither.
Have something public.
Yeah.
But I think again, there's so many types of data sources, and can, depending on the company, sometimes like a general database works, like a ZoomInfo.
Yeah.
Sometimes you have a niche need.
Yeah.
Like there's some customer of ours that needed to build a list of hotels in the Caribbean. Now, you're not going to get that off
ZoomInfo.
So there's sort of like these sources around general databases, niche-based databases, like a VAR association, custom list building, plugins. So LinkedIn's a great source of list building.
I think I saw one that actually looks at the job postings on Indeed to reverse the technographic profiles.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
That's crazy.
There's a bunch of so it used to be Datanize.
Yeah, Datanize, I think, was doing it.
They got bought by someone.
So it's like, I want to talk to hotels in Caribbean that use Salesforce.
Yep.
And they look at job postings to see if... That's so fascinating.
So like so much of things is you have list building and kind of like your list strategy can take some testing and trial, and everyone wants it to be simple, but usually it's not. It's usually simple to get a first list together and to start trying it.
Yeah.
But there's a lot out there. I wouldn't even pretend to be on top of it.
How
except
should somebody...
to know there's a lot of things you might have to sort through.
Yeah. So like as you're messaging, what's your strategy for... maybe somebody's not in market today, they're still a fit. Like, how do you manage the CRM so that they don't just get taken off the list forever? Like, is it, there's no new contact with that prospect for 3 months or 6 months, or like, how do you think of that?
Yeah. Well, so a common question is, well, I have a marketing team and I've got a sales team, how do you handle nurturing? So marketing generally should only market to people who've opted into the newsletter.
Mm-hmm.
Sales, and that's kind of the earlier stage ones, sales should kind of nurture, usually by kind of semi-manually, their list of people. And ideally, I like account-based sales, account-based outbound.
Yeah.
It's kind of tricky to do. But what that looks like is if I'm a prospector or a salesperson.
Like regions?
Well, first of all, you do need territories in some way.
Yeah.
Probably a different conversation. Like I just did an onsite with a company that had 150 people in sales, closers, field, inside, prospectors, without territories.
Whoa.
It's kind of every person for themselves.
Just go eat what you kill.
Yeah. And I think they knew they needed to.
That's a tough one if their culture.
But you need
not.
Territories when you're early, because otherwise there's just no...
It's
just so confusing to people what they should work on.
Yeah.
When I have a territory, which really could be geographic, industry, size, there's so many ways you can divide and conquer. I can be much more focused.
Mm-hmm.
So again, there's this trend of overwhelm.
Even your pitch. I mean, you customize the deck. Yeah.
A lot of what creates revenue growth is bringing focus to the organization in different ways. So that looks like type of customer.
Bomb drop for everybody listening.
Yep.
Yeah. Say that again. The way you create growth is...
The way you create growth for your sales and basically marketing and sales groups, your revenue team, is through more focus.
That's big.
So that looks like, focus on the right kind of customer. It's sales specialization, right? Prospect is your prospect, close is your close, because then they can focus on doing fewer things better. It's with your dashboards and metrics, focusing on the right kinds of quality and right kinds of metrics. It's kind of like there's so much quantity everywhere, like more leads, more people, more this, more that. And what's missing a lot is that quality conversation.
Mm.
Quality of customer, quality of appointment that prospectors are setting up, quality of the deal. I mean, I think in the sales world, quality pipeline is a very kind of well-established. But not so much like in dashboards, the quality of metrics. Now there's so many dashboard tools and metrics, we get this metric overwhelm. There's just all this clutter.
Yeah.
So again, too much stuff means how do we refocus on like fewer, better things across the whole revenue cycle, from prospecting, marketing, closing, accounts, roles, metrics, everything.
Who do you think should be responsible for upsells and cross-sells, say a CS or account?
Again, like so many things, it kind of depends. And I like this example of, there's a company called Guild, and we wrote about them in the Impossible book in the customer success section. I like that example because they have enterprise clients, mid-market, and small business. And the way they structured their comp and metric systems for their customer success team varied by segment. So in the customer success team, they had executive customer success, which is basically enterprise account management.
Yeah.
They were based on upselling. So customer success owned that at that point. In the mid-market, they had mid-market customer success, I don't remember the term.
Yeah.
And they were measured on renewal rates. And for kind of the small business section, they were measured on like usage. So again, it's like knowing your segments, knowing your customers, and what's the best way to manage that group of customers, which can vary segment to segment. Now, most SaaS companies end up with kind of small, medium, and large segments of some sort. And the sales models, to some extent, and teams vary by segment. Usually end up with like small business sales, mid-market enterprise. And prospectors, small, mid-enterprise prospectors, customer success, because they just tend to be different, more complex, high volume. But generally, I think what we recommend too is there's a CRO of some type.
I'm seeing that more and more.
Yeah. Well, so ultimately, like you need, you know, this whole thing on sales and marketing alignment.
And for you, and CRO is sales, marketing, and CS, or
can
is,
be.
Okay.
Yeah, it can be. And it's kind of at this point, it's like depending on the situation of the company. There's always one revenue leader. Mm-hmm. Now, I think the problem happens when you have a CEO and a VP of sales and a VP of marketing, and the CEO doesn't see themselves as the revenue leader in the sense of they need to be hands-on to integrate sales and marketing.
Yeah, the usually SLAs, there's, all that stuff.
Usually like, hey, VP sales, you figure it out, VP marketing, you figure it out, and you guys figure it out together, and I'll kind of check on things.
Yeah, that doesn't work.
No. They need to be involved.
Somebody needs to drive.
Drive things together. More common now, there's a CRO, Chief Revenue Officer, or like a VP Revenue, which is what we had.
And then RevOps, that's coming into
the
mix.
It's more common now.
Yeah.
But really, because you need to ensure that there's a kind of SDR in B2B, there's SDR teams that are helping bridge marketing and sales, and that marketing has metrics and quota relevant to sales.
So I've been seeing that. That's a new fun thing, the marketing quota. Essentially revenue quota for marketing.
Yeah, it can be a revenue quota if it's short enough, or even a quota based on qualified leads or qualified opportunities.
Yeah.
So I think if a lot of companies start with maybe a quota for new leads. Right? That's not really what sales cares about. So really, or even MQLs.
Yeah.
Again, not really what sales cares about. So there's still this problem if marketing is measured on MQLs.
Yeah, and sales wants
opportunities. Sales qualified leads.
Yeah.
So ideally, and it's a little bit more tricky, but measuring marketing on sales qualified leads generated. Because that's what sales cares about. And then you've got, theoretically, a happy marriage at that point. Because both care about the same metric.
Mm. Have you seen a more of a move amongst software companies for mid or lower? Like I heard that Slack doesn't really have quota carrying sales reps. They're more like account managers, but they're essentially doing demos, prospecting within the customer base, in a land and expand.
Yeah.
Like, do you think, people have said, your prospects are showing up with more information than most of your SDRs or your AEs.
Like, well, maybe.
Yeah. So I'm just wondering if, for a certain type of company, is that something they should consider?
So first of all, let me address this because there's this myth that, prospects are so educated. I mentioned this.
Yeah.
Prospects are so educated. They're showing up with all this information. And a few of them do. A few of them, there's kind of like this early adopter type. Early adopter, visionary, they get it. Right?
They're really interested.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's usually kind of
They're on lower G2 level. Crowd. They're like.
Yeah. They're like doing all the work. They'll read the white paper. They'll do the free trial. It could be engineers do that. Sometimes there's people, I don't know if that's like 15% of the people out there or 5% or 20%, but it's a minority. Jason, in my opinion, it's a minority. Most of them, people out there, are mainstream buyers. Mm-hmm. So for the earlier stage companies who a few hundred thousand, a few million, by definition, you're probably getting more of the early adopter types.
Yeah.
Because they find you, they're like, oh, this is so cool. I got it. Referrals. Yeah. But as you grow, you run into more of the people who they don't want to do all that. They don't want to do the research. It's a pain in their ass. I'm like this. I'm not going to read your white paper. Like, I would rather put in a demo request and for 15 minutes, you just tell me what I need to know.
Yeah. Here's my world. Tell me how you're going
to
make it better.
I'm not going to sort through all that crap.
Yeah.
You just tell me. Yeah. And I'll talk to two or three people like you. And it's like a really quick way to educate myself on what's out there.
Yeah.
And
make a decision.
So that's how most buyers are, especially as you get to bigger companies.
So there's still a sale that has to occur.
You still have to sell.
Yeah.
A lot of it is helping clarify for the buyer, kind of educate them in a way that is useful to them and helps them make a better decision.
Yeah.
Ideally for your product, but again, if their product is not a fit, if your product is not a fit for them, you should tell them. So again, I think it's salespeople need to be in this world of ideally kind of experts in the space. It's probably an aspiration and be able to really help. A lot of buyers need help from salespeople to make the right decision, especially at bigger companies. If you've been in a big company or sold to a big company, you realize it's really hard to buy things when you're in a big company. There's lots of approvals and lots of people to get on board.
They need assets.
It's a whole political process.
You got to sell it internally.
Yeah, sell internally.
Security gets assigned. Yeah,
and that's a huge value for a salesperson.
They can bring
is to
that.
Basically help a company buy something to just make
help
a decision
them buy.
To help them buy.
Yeah.
And make a decision.
Make a decision.
So the value of salespeople is really, really high. Salespeople aren't going anywhere. The nature of the job will change. SDRs aren't going anywhere. Because again, the more overwhelmed the world is, the more use in one situation that salespeople are there to help create clarity for buyers and what to do and how to improve their business.
Mm. At the last SaaS store, I believe it was the last one. I know they dripped the videos out, but I saw your talk about like things that founders do wrong when they build their first sales team or scale their sales team.
Yep.
How should somebody go from founder led? Like, do you believe there's a scenario where the founder shouldn't be selling? Like if they're, you know, introverted, socially awkward?
No,
pretty much. Okay, cool. So you need to learn how to sell your product.
That's like if they have a co-founder.
Yeah.
If there's two co-founders and
for
one
sure.
is the business person, but even then the introvert should be involved. You know, it's just sort of like to know.
Hear what the customer's saying.
Yeah.
And then how should they transition from that founder-led sales to a more scalable process?
No, it's great because we included in the new Impossible edition this section called...
That's what I thought, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Four phases to building your first sales
team.
That
was it, yeah. What are those phases?
Because like a really common mistake. I'm a founder. I have a business. I'm too busy. You're tired of selling. Hire a salesperson to take over. Right? And usually that doesn't work.
Yeah.
Because like I've got the founder magic. Also, my expectations are totally unrealistic about how fast it'll take to ramp
this
person.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, in 2 months, they should be selling. Yeah. It might take them 9 months.
And you have nothing documented.
You're still like figuring things out.
Yeah.
And you hired someone who worked at Salesforce.
Yeah.
Right. But they never worked in like a really raw startup. Right. Because they had the Salesforce brand and they had all
the
these
training.
Advantages.
They followed the checklist. Yeah.
Yeah. They have documentation, case studies. And here you have nothing.
No assets.
So, So I would say like you want to de-risk the process because if you hire the wrong person, which happens so often, phase zero is that CEO founder is selling themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Involve in whether you're actually doing this selling or you're involved heavily, but you need to do that so you know how it's working, what customers want, what they object to, what's not working. And then when you do hire someone in sales, you have a bit more of a sense of pattern recognition for what kind of person do you want. And when they start, how would you work with them and coach them? So again, founders should really be involved in selling. It's so important for the first 10 or 20 customers. First hire would be a junior salesperson, like an SDR. So they could be responding to inbound leads, doing prospecting, basically handling appointment setting or lower level sales things the founder doesn't want to do.
Yeah, throughput.
Yep. So 3 to 6 months, you get that working. Okay, now you have a bit more of a stable place to hire. Either hire a salesperson in, because now they've got like some sort of lead gen system, or promote that person to selling and hire another junior person. But the next phase is you end up with kind of the CEO, and then there's like one SDR and a salesperson. Okay, then after that, another 3 to 6 months, you hire, you have two of each, two junior people, two closers. Okay. And then a leader, typically. It's better to bring a VP of sales on or that type once you've got a team working. There's something there to work with.
Because they're expensive hires.
They're expensive. The good ones are expensive hires.
Yeah.
It's rare to find someone who not only can kind of like be the first person selling, but then build the team and
like
lead
a player
it.
Player coach. Yeah.
Yeah. Cause kind of you at different stages of the company, you different types of VPs of sales.
Totally.
Right. There's the beginning. There's the evangelist, which is usually like the founder.
Yeah.
And then, from 0 to 1 million and then from 1 to 10 million, you need someone who can try to figure out how to make it repeatable.
Yeah.
And then from 10 million to like 40 million
instrumentation,
someone to scale
training. Talent
yeah. Like
pipeline.
It's repeatable. How do we just grow it? Which is more like hiring people and territories and systems and management and leadership. And then, 40 million plus or 100 million plus, it's like dashboards, metrics, and some more. So that person evolves. And this is from Jason Lemkin. He had a great way to interpret this. It's just hard to get people who can go through more than a couple stages.
Totally.
So again, if you're going to make an expensive hire, less risk if you have something there that's working for them to work with. And in the meantime, if the entrepreneur is kind of leading the team or getting some part-time help with mentoring, the thing is, it's just so valuable to be in the trenches with the sales team, even if you feel like you're making mistakes, because all of that will pay off later in terms of knowing what product to avoid, how to hire, how to train people. You don't waste your time that way. The only way you can waste your time is if you waste the learning opportunity.
That's presented. I remember, I think it was, is it Dan Chait from Greenhouse? I know Jason's had him speak, but Greenhouse, I think it was Daniel Chait. He from New York was talking about kind of like the lean approach to sales development, and same exactly what you described, but like pods. Like he was like, the person sits next to you as the founder, you guys collectively try stuff, document it. And I just thought it was a really clear way of doing it that felt less risky, less
exposed.
Yeah,
you kind of do, it's like basically agile.
Yeah, so agile, you're trying to like speed up the learning.
I think companies are trying to, David Skok, who's the VC at Matrix, had this really great point that I liked, which was most companies' common mistake is they're trying to skip a step. And he said, the first step one is product market fit. Step two should be finding a repeatable, predictable sales model. Mm-hmm. Amen. And step three is scaling. And too many companies get product market fit, and you get your first 5, 10, 15, 20 customers and like, let's hit it. Let's go.
Yeah, rocket fuel.
And you don't realize how much longer it usually takes for companies to figure out though that interim step, which is that repeatable, scalable, predictable sales model, lead generation and sales model that can take, it could take months, it could take years. It's probably, like if you're building a new sales team from scratch, it's probably 2 years to get the team, SDRs, AEs, whatever, that team in place with a leader and okay, this, I can kind of like let it go. It's probably a couple of years.
Yeah.
And it's like most of you never have all the kinks worked out. And actually the bigger it gets, the more problems there are. But to have that team and model working in a repeatable way and like trusting the metrics and it's probably a couple of years.
Do you feel like, I remember a decade ago, 2008, I moved to San Francisco and I felt like the word sales team was like evil. Like,
sure.
Like it's crazy. And now it's just, everybody's cool with it and we talk about it and it's kind of expected. What do you think changed? Is it like the founder purist about product that they were all like, the product should sell itself and now we're realizing like for certain.
Still a lot of people think that.
They still think that.
Yeah. Well, I think a lot of it was people realized like I did when I had a company that failed. And I don't think I had I don't remember my connotation over sales. I just thought it was like, I don't know, sales. Fuck, like we need to make money. I think that's most of it is like, that makes you money.
Yeah.
And companies want to make money. So I feel like predictable revenue helped. There's 100%. Just a lot more sales knowledge, a lot of great writers on sales and like Jason Lemkin. So I think there's this recognition, this broader recognition, and there's so many more entrepreneurs that to be successful, you need predictable revenue. You need a sales model. The sales makes you money. And I would say sales is a life skill. So I still find that most people have a lot of negative connotations. There's lots of entrepreneurs, especially, that have negative connotations with sales.
Yeah.
Rightly so. I don't know.
Yeah, they've been exposed to the sleazy car deal for salespeople.
But I think, too, so first of all, a lot of the resistance for people in terms of, hey, there's this dream of, I'm just going to build a product and people are going to love it and come buy it.
Yeah, these indie hackers, that's their dream.
And partly that's been promoted by kind of stories of what Instagram or, which is like one, focused. It's a lottery, there's no stories of people that it does work, but there's also a lot of fear where for a lot of people being able to kind of like sit back and kind of code something, write something, and then people just buy it. Feel it's like safe. A very comfortable, it's very safe.
Yeah.
And to think about going and marketing yourself and selling yourself and your product is very scary.
No.
Yeah. And rejecting is very threatening.
Yeah.
I know I've been that way and realizing that to embrace selling again is a life skill where if you want to start a nonprofit, get a promotion,
you want to hire people,
it's like sales is a life skill and you need to be able to sell yourself an idea or a product if you want to accomplish anything in life.
Yeah.
I mean, some of the best salespeople in history have been like Mother Teresa, right? Elon Musk, John F. Kennedy, if you look at it that way. So sales is a life skill. You don't have, doesn't have to be any kind of negative
connotation.
Manipulative.
There's nothing. Baggage. I mean, if you think about what you said earlier, but like just your job is to help somebody make a decision.
The right decision for them.
Which, like that's selling. I mean, you're just doing asking them the questions they don't even know to ask themselves.
Yeah. And by the way, because if you're targeting the right kinds of customers, hopefully the right decision for them to help them is to
use
buy
your
stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
If you were to buy a SaaS product today to scale to like 100 million, what would the characteristics of that business model look like for you?
I mean, if I was going to buy a product and like run
it. Yeah, you buy something instead of a million ARR and then grow it. What would you want to, what are you looking for?
Well, the funny thing is, I feel like so many companies that have like a million to ARR are so missing so many opportunities of revenue growth that it wouldn't be that hard to at least, I don't know about 100 million, but to like,
yeah, but grow what it by is it, what's true about the ACVs or the customer segments for you? I'm just curious, Aaron, like what's,
I mean, I like bigger ACVs typically. It's hard to build a big business out of small
25K
deals.
Plus.
Yeah, 25K and up. I think too, there's a lot of, it's hard to tell when a product is kind of like an add-on, like a plug-in, nice to have, versus when it's like a really, must have and a really useful tool that you need.
So you'd be looking more workflow tools or verticalized.
You know, the thing is, I don't think it's that hard for if you're an investor, right?
Yeah.
And you have companies coming in who already have some like a growth rate. So those are kind of easy. You feel like that'd be pretty easy to spot. Like if they're already growing.
Yeah.
The question is, if it's not already growing, how do you spot the potential? And I think too, you know, it really comes down to how big is the target market? How painful is that problem you're solving?
Yeah.
Right. It's kind of like the basic stuff. Who's your customer? Or how many of them, how much will they pay you?
Set.
You know, and today, whether it's in, the thing I like about like sales and marketing is because people like to pay money if they're going to make money. Like HR is a little harder, usually. There's a lot of great tools in HR.
Fucking HR is so hard.
Yeah, because, you know.
K-12.
I'm spending money, yeah. So I, you know, for me, I would look at something in the sales and marketing. I also know that world.
It pulls.
Yeah, I just know it better. So I think there's a lot of great companies. There's a lot of opportunity. And yeah. I think that most companies really are missing the boat on basic sales and lead gen playbook steps. Yeah,
sales motion
that they
stuff.
They just don't do. They just don't do. Specializing sales roles. The most common mistake. I saw a study from the Bridge Group that 75% of SDR teams, again, they're expected to do, people have to do both inbound lead response and outbound prospecting. Horrible no-no.
70%, wow.
75%, wow. So.
Specialize.
Like ABCs.
Yeah.
Specialize. The right way, all the way.
10 years, you go back 10 years, you know, I don't know how many children you had at that point, but going on
11, zero.
Okay, wow.
Yeah.
You know.
0 to 9 kids, and it's like 6 years actually.
Yeah, so you've got the kids, you've got the $5 million year business, the consulting, you're a thought leader in the space, the books. Who did you need to become to be the person to do all that today?
Well, really, so the cheesy answer was really like a better person of myself, but I think
what were those characteristics?
So, you know, everyone has different fears, anxieties, and doubts. Some people it shows up in business, some people it shows up at home. For me, I think I had put off like things like publishing the book. So I think what I have learned to do is really just jump forward, just kind of like say yes to things like more kids, more adoptions, book, business. Being okay with being busy all the time. So a challenge today is I have an overwhelming number of things I juggle. Like we're moving the family to Scotland. And my wife has been, had a play and has, you know, had a health challenge. And so I kind of was having to run my part of the business and manage the family and manage the money and, you know, so it's learning how to juggle. And for me, a lot of that's based on calendaring and kind of doing the things that just feel the most important. I got to be really good years ago about putting things off. So I think one of the easiest ways to create time is just to put stuff off.
Is that procrastinating or saying no?
That's saying no.
Okay.
It can be either way, but usually it's saying no.
Okay.
It's this balance where I think on one hand, I'm good about putting things off, and I've been better about just trying to get things done instantly and kind of judging what that is. Cause you know, so it's kind of this weird, you want both habits. Sometimes I got to be too good at putting things off and not good about just like doing something now. Cause my task list might just be like call lawyers, there's just all these things.
Yeah.
So calendaring works for me, like a block out. Time. I don't get to the gym. The only way I get to the gym, cause for years I didn't, I have certain times I show up with a trainer. Forcing function, right? I'm hiring someone who is really good.
Hey, it's a tax.
Yep.
If you don't show up or, you know, like you're accountable.
Yep. Forcing functions. So it's kind of someone who really was able to jump into this world of being super busy, not really in realizing I didn't need as much kind of downtime as I thought I needed. Not even knowing where I had anxiety or fear in life and being willing to overcome that. Like I was afraid of being a father.
Dude, you've gone way on the other end of that.
Yeah, I know. And part of it's like, would I be a good parent? I didn't have as much fear of adoption. I would have before. So with adoption, here's an interesting example. So getting married to my wife, she had two kids from a prior marriage. Right? And I had these fears around, would I want to be a father? Would I want to be a stepfather? Would I be a good father? And maybe, you know, I had to kind of be like, say yes and jump into, I want to be married and be a father and just not try to get those anxieties answered ahead of time. Just like be yes and just kind of go 100% in. I never use the word step child. It's always like my son, my daughter. And then that was kind of like emotionally adopting them. So by the time we talked about adopting, I was like, yeah, I know I pretty much had been through it already. Not legally their parent because there's a bio father who's still alive. But I had a lot of my fears around adopting already kind of be, vanquished or been through that. Because what I see with a lot of people is there's lots of people who say, oh, yeah, we've talked about adopting. No, I haven't done it yet. It's easy to talk. Or I wouldn't want to adopt because why would I want to, take care of someone's child or like, yeah. What if there's problems? What if they're kind of broken? Totally valid concerns. But on the other side of that is, the value, having
incredible
for us,
opportunity to learn.
Yeah, learn. And we don't adopt for some noble cause. And usually, feels right, but the what it adds to the family is so incredible in terms of variety and great kids. And yeah, there's challenges. Like, we adopted she's now three, a baby who had her mom was on drugs. Mm-hmm. But she's doing great. Are there going to be challenges in the future? Yeah, but it's kind of worth it.
Yeah.
It's kind of knowing that jumping into things 100%. It's easy to see the cost of them, like cost of time, cost of money. It's harder to see the value of it.
Yeah.
And now I just tend to trust around, moving to Edinburgh, adopting someone else. It could be like, I can see the challenges and just trusting that by going all in, the benefits will be there.
That's amazing.
And a good family, I gave a talk first time, finally forcing function. I'm like, I got to do something with parenting, like juggling parenting and money.
Yeah.
Finally said at the conference, I'll do one talk if you let me do this other one. Like, I'll do the predictable revenue talk if you let me do the parenting talk.
I've got this one I want to do for me.
And so the title was building a $5 million business while raising 10 kids. And one of the ideas I shared there was this trade-off, which was the idea of lots of kids for most people be like, oh, like so busy and so expensive, which is totally true.
Yeah.
Hell yes.
It's expensive. Yeah.
But, and I had, let's call it a few $100,000 in savings or so on before I got married. I invested all of that in the family and went into debt over the years. Adoptions are expensive, man, like $40,000. And we had to move from one house to the next. We went from $2,000 a month to $3,500 to $8,500 to $17,000 a month in rent down to $12,000 a month in just rent.
Yeah.
We spend...
Can't imagine your food bill.
No, it's $5,000 a month probably.
Easily.
Yeah. So... what's interesting is I said, okay, trading, it's this pro and con. I traded financial security or financial savings for financial confidence. Mm. By having to deal with all these financial challenges and making money, saving money, spending money, I had all the same fears going into debt. Just kind of like getting over that. Like, what's the big deal?
No pressure, no
diamonds.
It was
an investment, right? We weren't, it's investing in things like could be a nanny or a vacation.
Yeah, learning how to manage your time better.
Yeah, so traded in financial savings for financial confidence. Traded abundance of time for a appreciation of time. Mm. I wasted so much time
prior.
Now I have, and I still waste a lot, but I have so much more of an appreciation of the time I have because it's limited, right? My wife is here. We have a couple days together. It's so rare. I was like, oh my God, it's amazing. And I'm already sad that's going to be over soon. So this preciousness of, I waste a lot less, whether it's like money, time. So again, it's an investment. In other words, letting go of, growth is comfort is the enemy of growth. Mm-hmm. Comfort's the enemy of success. I was comfortable, as a single person, kind of making just enough money,
easy.
Kind of doing my thing. And I'm a lot busier. There's more stress. I make a lot more money, but I spend a lot more money. I don't go to the gym as much and so on, blah, 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 but it's totally worth it. And kind of be willing to give up what I had for what I didn't know I would get, but just jump into growth. Just do something new, go for it.
And say yes more often.
Yes more often in bigger ways too.
That's awesome. Aaron, appreciate you so much for coming on. Where can people find you online?
Get your book.
Yeah, that's from impossible.com.
Yeah, right? From impossible.com.
And then
it's a must.
We do for like speaking, consulting, outbound prospecting help, predictablerevenue.com is our business.
Awesome. Go check them out. Aaron, thanks again.
Yeah, thanks, Dan.
Thanks for watching this episode of Escape Velocity. Be sure to like and subscribe and leave a comment with your biggest insight from our conversation. Be sure to check out the next episode.